Okay. In the model we were just talking about, it seems that the corporate entities that have a function but are not everything, they sort of represent the ego, which gets in the way of stripping away illusion, which is also what you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you use the ego or tame the ego to strip away illusion and go into the unknown?
This is by interacting with one another, or interacting with the least expected entity, and interacting with the next door neighbor that you have never spoken to, maybe because they're from another country, they look different, everything like that, but interacting with them, with, this is the name of the album that I'm gonna, that's gonna come out, that I'm working on now.
Mm-hmm.
Interacting with them and interacting with factions, aspects of light without a net. That's the name of my album, Without a Net. A good friend of ours, she passed away, an actress. She was at the club we played in called, we played a club one time for in a long time, Yoshi's. Mm. And she was there. She was, her name is Vanetta McGee. She made a movie with Clint Eastwood called The Iger Sanction years ago. And when she left, before she left, she was looking at us, she said, you guys are playing without a net. And when she left, about 4 weeks later, she passed away. And her, we went to her memorial and all that. Her husband's an actor, too. And then we were with these scientists in North, I'm going to give you that question, but we were in North Carolina, and some of these scientists, they heard the word, they said, Without a Net. Is that a song title? Is that the title of the album? So interacting, and I said, beyond belief, and some people say, I don't do such and such because I don't have any faith in something. I don't have any faith in this. I don't believe in this. So you say, you have to maybe just, it's like, I don't know how to swim, but you have to go into the deep end. And that's, without a net, is it's the yellow brick road, you know. It's how do you do that? It's for a businessman to do business as if he doesn't know, as if he's never gone to business school. Clay, can you play like you don't know how to play? That you never took a music lesson? It would be, they would call it a gamble without any guarantees, and to convince someone to take a leap without a net, to interact together, and they're going to see what happens. It would take it will take a corporate body and the so-called creative body to agree on one thing, that there is no net in reality. They are unprotected, really. And even protection is an illusion. That's temporary, too. You say, well, we've been protected for millions of years. And when someone says, I want to be wealthy for a zillion years, for my children, everything, da, 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 da. And I say, a zillion years is like a blink in the eye. It's a blink in the eye.
Not to people who are suffering.
Yeah. In the moment beats the blink in the eye. It takes courage to go into that moment. But when you find out that a zillion years of having something your way it's a blink of an eye is an ass kicking that you don't want to go through. Because the ass kicking is going to seem like it's forever, and some people call that hell. And hell on earth. But you don't have to believe that, because it's beyond your perception to believe what you accept what you, you know. So things are happening now to kind of forming this. Life is forming an answer to that question in a sense right now. And if we're smart enough, and the people are so-called cool and hip and people who
I have my philosophy together,
people who think they can see this and see that, we're all going to say we're in it together. Let's I don't think it may take hitting the bottom of the barrel for humility to emerge in human existence. I mean, on mass scale of a human emergence, you know. What is it going to take? Sometimes it takes a single person. They have the songs that the world can change with a single man. That has happened historically, a single person, because people embracing what a single sentence or something like that. Yeah. But then there's always been usage, you know. It becomes a feudal system again. You got your vassals and serfs and lords and keeping it that way educationally. And then,
But speaking of education, you'll be teaching, your students will, of course, ask you, how do I do this? How do I tame the ego?
Mm-hmm.
How can I ignore human nature?
Okay. I think you can start with, at the Monk Institute, when we auditioned these kids who are there now, the ones who are going to be for the two-year program, we were talking to them. What are you looking for? You know, and if we saw the answers came back, the response was mostly on, it can hide it. You know, they want to use that as a stair step for their career. I want to score for movies. It's like a me thing. This time we got, I was teaching, doing some, part-time teaching at some place, some institute or whatever. And the other one, I want to make sure that the people who are coming along with us and after, and we were hearing some sincere, you know. One guy came in to audition with the trombone and Jimmy, Jimmy, he walked, the guy walked in his suit, and he said, "Hey, Wayne, you look like an insurance man." But when he played, it had some of that K-winning DJ, Frank Russellino stuff, and himself, and Al Gray had all that stuff in there. Young guy, too, he said, and he said, everybody's chair went back like we had to chair something like this. Whoa! And I think that these examples kind of spell out something about what do you do about the ego. It's a xylophone player from Chile. He played Sophisticated Lady. They all played the. And I had to go to the in the washroom for a second, and I kind of missed it. I came back, and Herbie said, he was there. Kenny Burrell, he was one, you know. Herbie said, "Wayne, you, this guy." And he played something else, and I heard what they were talking about. And Jimmy, here comes Jimmy, he said, "Where did you get all that street stuff from in Chile?" I mean, almost like New York, you know, like that. He has a history. from Chile. And there's a drummer. The piano. The piano did some hurry did like with his chair. These guys. And we saw something about, to answer that question, we saw examples of behavior that taught for that moment. I'm going to go in October 3rd to be with one of the first classes there. You know, just 3 hours with them. An example of what they're, how they follow through about this ego thing. There's some a substantial amount of humility that seems that they can illuminate. I'm gonna see, I'm gonna follow through on that without baiting. I'm not gonna bait them, but I want to see. And these people exist already. It seems like they're kind of hard to find, but now the way things are, and I answer your question is, there's more than one kind of people coming out of closets. These people are coming out of closets, some really thinking people, sensitive, coming out. It's like, is the coast clear? Can we come out now? And here we were in a nest of scientists caring about the Amazon with their lives on the line, knowing that one night, or people don't want them there, you know, the mafia, between the government and all that stuff, young, in their 30s, early 30s, and I'm saying, where are they coming from? And then, these think tanks, that's a big closet. They're coming out of those closets. But it's not just head. Not just head. Because we went to reception. Here, to answer the question, we went to reception after we did the fundraiser in North Carolina, or Winston-Salem, whatever. Girls! Of course, saxophones. They had a band. They were playing. And in Japan, when TWA crashed and my wife passed away on that one, I went right to Japan, maybe 4 weeks here, and then went to Japan. And in the club, when they had the Blue Notes in Japan, there's a line of people wanting to sign their instruments. About most of the girls, they were young girls with horns, alto saxophones and everything. Danilo just came from South Korea with his wife, Patty. She was alto sax. He said she played too. She took the course at NYU, music therapy, to get her master's. And they're home schooling their children. The children studying Chinese and everything. And the Spanish, Chinese, and English. And he said, Patricia, her name is Patricia, whose mother is one of the leading neurosurgeons in Chile. I'm not saying you have to have all this stuff in your genes and everything, but they have 3 children now, and she went to South Korea with her husband, with Danilo, and he said, Patty, it's playing, man, she's playing. John Patitucci's wife is a cellist. Her ego was under, she put her ego to raise the children and everything. And when John and I talked, he said, my wife, Sachi, her name, she's part Japanese and everything. He said, Sachi, gotta get back to the cello. She gotta. So John goes up to Berkeley and drives up there and teaches and everything. He's trying to make more room so his wife, and people are watching this. They're watching. People have to observe humility. That's how you're going to see it. They ain't going to show it on television, maybe some good movie that you look up on. That looks, independent. For instance, here's some humility. Daisaku Ikeda, Didn't have something about? When he was 19, he heard about this philosophy. Someone asked, is that Buddhism you're doing? Is it a religion? And so the actor who played in, he played a detective. It was a comedy. He was at our house here at a meeting, and he said, someone asked him that question. He said, the Buddhism we're practicing is a philosophy, which I try to practice religiously. And I always tell people, what's greater than religion than being alive? Life is the ultimate reglio. You can say this is a religion, but it's the philosophy. So Daisaku Kida, he was 19, and he became the president. He's 80-something now. And some of the people around me said, I'd like to be like that. I'd like to have those attributes. Like, wow, he made it all those years. So this practice is going on in 192 countries now. The person he saw was the second president. His name was Jose Toda. And he wrote, as 19, he said, the intellectual, philosophical tenets and all that, that was not what attracted me to this philosophy. What attracted me was Mr. Toda's behavior. The man before Toda, his name was Tsunesaburo Makaguchi. He was a school teacher, arithmetic teacher in Hokkaido. He got from the first Buddhist writings, the last one, the Lotus Sutra, the 80,000 Sutra, the Lotus one, he was checking it out, and he said, the government is wrong. Tojo and all those guys, they're wrong. They put him in jail. He died in jail. They put him and Toda in jail. A lot of people don't know the history of that. I got history of India. Phoenicians went all the way around and landed there. And the first recorded person who was enlightened as a Buddha, named Sakyamuni. But I'm talking about, and I'm not trying to sell something here, but it's like behavior. It's just watching the behavior. And it's the behavior. And when Charlie Chan, the movies, his son would say, how did you solve that case, Pop? And he would say, simple deduction, my son. Simple deduction. And when one of the first meetings I went to, the Buddhist meeting, they said, the Western world thinks inductively. And the Orient is deductive. I said, what is that thing? He said, well, I lived on 10 South Street when I was a child, 10 South Street in Newark, New Jersey, and I thought that 10 South Street in Newark, New Jersey was the whole world. That's inductive thinking. He said, the part of something is treated as the whole. I'm going to specialize in orthodontics. That's in school. You must specialize. That's the whole. You keep the dots disconnected that way. But deductive, he says, this life is a whole, and the parts take care of, come into it. You did that algebra problem backwards from the inside out, you know. So that was just a way of, you know. So this, not to think that politeness, being polite, is an indication of being having humility. Sometimes, that's just a cover, you know, because in Asian, something like in the doing world, we're so sorry, being very polite, and then, you know. But there is a real something that even historically. There's a samurai, his name was Musashi. He was the greatest samurai, and he stopped fighting, although no one could beat him, but he said he was actually searching for enlightenment. And then he held on with humility. And when he was said, gominasai, sorry, I'm very sorry, he meant it. So people, I have the movie, I sent for it, great actor. He played in Grand Prix before he died. Toshiro Mifune. Wow. Yojimbo and all that stuff. Yeah.
Teaching in no samurai.
Yeah. So the humility, I think the answer is that it has to be observed. And asking for it, like, we need more good movies and more books. Calling for it, the cause, and the effect will come out. But it's an emergency now, so we have to exert ourselves. Exert yourselves in the way of the Buddha. The Buddha nature. It's very interesting, the Buddha nature is asleep, dormant, but when you you call it this name, it comes out.
Can I ask you a question about that?
Yeah.
If Buddha is here with us today, and who's to say he's not, what would you like to ask him or talk with him about or do with him?
Well, you know, it's not a person. That's what we find. They always say there's God, Allah, and Buddha. Sakyamuni was saying he has we all have a Buddha nature, which could be, he said, this is almost 3,000 years ago. He said it's going to be asleep in every individual now, but it can be brought out. When we ask the question of the Buddha within us, there's a mirror that we're looking at. And this mirror is called the Gohonzon. And this mirror is a reflection of your life condition inside. The life condition is a reflection of an enlightened life condition that we all possess, but hasn't, you know. And this Gohonzon is a scroll. It's not something that you worship. And then to give an example of that, they say it's like a mirror, like a woman. If a woman worshipped her image in the mirror or this paper, instead of putting lipstick on her, she would put it on the mirror. So as time goes on, when we practice and we say the name of the Lotus Sutra, we say the name of it, because the name of the Lotus Sutra, it's a whole, everything in this book, all the words and pictures are contained in the title. So that's for people who couldn't read or see, that once they heard the name, they would say the name. And it said some of these people, there were two brothers, the Ikigami brothers, back in, I learned a lot about Asian history. If you called one, the other one would come. They said, like, ignorant. But they heard the name of the Lotus Sutra, and they would say it. And these two brothers became enlightened so fast, they became like helping people. And like they were like before you. You want this? You get this? Help. You know, this faster than these intellectuals. And in the beginning of the one of the, I'll just stop right here. But then in the beginning of one of the wordings of the sutra, it says, doorway of this philosophy is very difficult for the intellectual, the intelligentsia, to enter, but they will. Yeah. They're going to study by now. I'm going to study in libraries and monasteries. I'm not going to tell you what I know. This is my union. This is my secret. That's Hinayana. The other is Mahayana.
So
for the people.
Okay. For some of the musicians you've been talking about today, whether it's Art Blakey or Miles Davis or maybe Joe Zawinul or Charlie Parker, do you think they all had Buddha nature in them?
Oh, yeah.
Does everyone, or does it?
Yeah.
Is there something special about their nature?
No, you know what? The world, you see, all the universities now, there's something that was decreed in the world that the Lotus Sutra, they decreed many universities that the Lotus Sutra, it was the first historic document they call it a document that speaks of the equality of all people, men and women, gender, everything, equality. And before that time, they had, back in India, they had the men had 500 and something sins and some other things that they had to overcome, and women had 2,500, and a woman can never be enlightened until she comes reborn as a man and all that. So when Sakyamuni came on and said, the hell, they ain't that way at all. So, but I like that this is, I said, wait a minute, he didn't write nothing down. It's in the moment when it happened to him, it happened to him when he was 19. He was a prince. And he looked over the wall. They wouldn't let him out of the wall. And he looked and he saw people suffering. And he said, why is there birth, suffering, old age, and death? Why is that? And he sneaked out of the palace one time and never came back. He came back later, but he was 92 when he died. And he didn't. But His mother and wife, he had a Sudana, his wife, they all started, let's do it together. So it's very mystical. But the humanity, it points, oh man, I got some stuff with scientists. They're talking about, I got the Stephen Hawking's stuff. We talked about the universe created itself. Hmm. You have that one? And but he's bringing all the other scientists into it. He's going all. He's bringing what they have arrived at, what they accomplished, and then he starts. The universe created itself. I have a tape of him talking. Side A and side B, and when I put side B on, he starts saying, "Are there boundaries in space?" I turn it off. And say, I'll hear that one later. You know, so.
What do you think the answer to that question is?
There are no boundaries. There are no boundaries. But I made a record with a guitarist from Japan, and his friend used to bring Stephen Hawking to Japan, Tokyo, from Oxford or whatever, to do lectures with the wheelchair and all that stuff. And this guitarist made a record and asked me to play on the record with him. And he said, oh, by the way, I got Dr. Hawking. He's going to open the record for us. So I have one at home, it's on Toshiba, and Stephen Hawking opens the record. He said, there are at least 200 million, billion, whatever, stars in our galaxy. And he goes on, and he talks about them, and then the music starts. And we went to Nathan East's studio to record something, the overdubs, and the guitarist is married to one of a great actress in Japan. She was there, and when he was recording, and they had like a partition, glass, and all that. He jumped, and she said, he hears it. I said, hears what? And they told me that when he lived in Hawaii, he was 2 hours, he can't account for 2 hours, he was sleeping upstairs. He had upstairs and downstairs, a duplex. He was sleeping, and he woke up in the morning, and all his bedclothes, the sheets, at the foot of the bottom of some stairs. And he can't account for 2 hours. And he has an indentation here, here, and behind his ears. And he would hear something ding-a-ling-a-ling-a. And while he was recording, he heard. And so I got a piece of music paper, and I said, let's write it down. I wrote it down, the notes. And then it was my turn to record. I went and I played those notes. It's still on the record. Within the, you know, and he's in Japan now with his wife, and he used to go on expeditions with Whitley Strieber, who did, you know, Communion and all those, you know, and he and Whitley Strieber went to the house that Tesla used to live in New York, the apartment building, down, they found in the basement, part of the electric coil that Tesla sat in the middle of, the electrical storm, and then he asked me to go with him on Alaska, the Dew Line. I was in the Dew Line when I was in the Army, to witness the Aurora Borealis, with Whitley Strieber and some other scientists, but I couldn't. I was going on the road. And then he got married and moved to Japan. So I'm going to Japan in March, and I think he'll, when we go to Japan, we always get a cake from her. She's a well-known actress there. And he's settled now, and they have two children. And he says he's always watching the, he's measuring his daughter's waist to see if it's, you know, and checking her out as she grows. He said, her name is Monet. He said, I'm checking out Monet. And the other one, too, he said, I'm checking. You still checking them? Yeah, okay. So it's a very interesting. Listen, the guy used to come and this is a part of the things that motivate the story to tell. When I was 18, there was a union guy. He used to collect at the end of the week and all that. One Sunday, he knocked on our door. It was a Sunday, yeah, day off. And there he is standing there, the union guy. I said, what's the union guy? He had a valise, big valise. He said, I have a proposition. He opened the valise. My mother let him in, you know, because we knew his name and everything. And we had a round kitchen table, and he opened his valise and took out this blueprint and put it on the table. And it was round. And it had all these, you know, I was 18, markings and everything, and like equations. Later on, I was like, the word equation. And I said, what is this? He said, since Sarah Vaughan was from Newark, James Moody was, you know, James lived down the street from me. I didn't know, because I was 15. I had no idea to become a musician. I didn't know he lived down the street. His sister was in grammar school with me. Sit right over there. Vivian Moody. He said, I want to get all the people to get together and see if we can get a concert, raise enough money to build this. I said, build it. And my mother was talking to him, what do you want to, why do you want to build this? He said, so we can go home. He talked, and I'm trying to be, because I like science fiction, and I got fresh, and I said, how does this thing go? He said, by dividing the magnetic lines of force at right angles. Later on, when I went to NYU, he finally left and everything. I'll tell you something else strange, too. I had Dr. Dragner in physical science. He was he worked on the first cyclotron at Columbia. He was one of the, I'm sitting there, Lou Gossett sitting next to me in class. And I raised Dr. He's talking about something electromagnet. Dr. Dragner, what does it mean to divide lines of force at right angles? He said, who you been talking to? He said, see me after class. Mm. And after class, he said, you know, if we could do that, we're going to put mobile, Texaco, all them out of business. But we don't even know what electricity is yet. And before Walter Davis died, you know Walter Davis? He's making his own clothes and everything. He made suits and everything. He cured himself of this and that. He gets on the phone with me. He said, Wayne, he said, I'm ready. I said, what do you mean? I'm ready to build this spacecraft. He said, we got to build this spacecraft. That's where I'm at too. And I said, okay, let's build it. How are we going to do it? He said, we're going to get some people together, get some money. We're going to do some fundraising. We're going to build this. He said, I got the plans. And then he passed away. Mm. That was odd, you know. After all that time, he never went to class. He and his twin brother at Orange, New Jersey, or East Orange, and they just go take the final exams, you know. And he would take Bud Powell's place when Bud couldn't make it. And this is a, we don't know. So there's a lot of, when somebody's playing now, I'm almost demanding, I don't ask them, you got a story to tell me? You got a story? You know, even one made up or one, or something that influences, your contribution to the mystery of us. What is that? The mystery of us is a great adventure, and pursuit of the constant. Don't let the temporaries fool you. When I signed some papers to take my mother's ashes and my wife's ashes, we did it in Florida, my brother's ashes to a place out of the country. The man who signed the papers, I'm standing at the desk, he's Japanese, in California. Then he got up, he had the white shirt on, he said, "Wanna do some exercise with me?" Like in Japan, how they do it, he did. The whole office, I said, okay. He did about 5 minutes of that. He said, "Thank you." And as I was leaving, went to the elevator, somebody in the elevator said, "He just lost his wife 5 days ago." He said, he knows what you're doing. He knows what's going on in you, he's showing you something. You know. I said, he was born in this philosophy, this wide. Okay. He said, he knows about the temporary and the constant. Okay. He's going to see his wife. She said, his wife's on vacation. It's serious, man. It's okay. So that, some writers have been daring. They didn't daring us. Some reviews just lately, said, these guys, Daniel and all of them, I say those guys, he said, reaching for the impossible. And so I'm saying, why not? And if we can do that without looking like egomaniacs on a stage, go for it, because you're going to have to do that undressed. You have to be ready to forget all your foundation. Don't be showing off your musical foundation, your study. I study this and I know this. They say, if there's a train wreck, let the train wreck show the audience struggle. Don't be ashamed. Just show some struggle. You're reaching and you can't do it, you're going to struggle. Then in the struggle, show victory. You're going to break through it. And the audience, they get it. Say, wow. That stuff you guys were doing, and then you said, "I was with you," and he said, "That's what I want to do with the school I'm going." You know, a few people do that. You know, and Herbie went on a tour with Lang Lang, and he said after in the dressing room, four classical pianist kids came back stage, and they said, "We're improvising now. We're playing jazz. We do that." And there's a little girl sitting in the front, a violinist in Europe. She's an American girl, and her mother, after, in Marciac, the south of France. Little girl was standing there after we played, and the girl started talking, and the mother put her hand over her. "Don't, you know, speak when you're spoken to." The girl said, "That's all right, mommy." She said, and she looked right straight at us, and she said, "I know what you're doing." She had a little violin on her. "I know what you're doing." And it's Dudamel, he's the director of the LA Phil. He's going out with the Simon Bolivar Sistema, the young people. "Have you heard the Sistema do the Shostakovich dance?" It's on your iPad. Man, I'm telling you. And then it's fifth and all whatever. They're like 17, 18, 19 years old now. And then Danilo's going to play Carnegie Hall with some of them, maybe 16 of them from the Simon Dunamel's, part of that orchestra. I heard Herbie play Rhapsody in Blue at the Disney Hall with the LA Phil, and Dudamel conducted something before that from South America, you know. And he conducted the Rhapsody in Blue. And when they finished, I'm up on the balcony, how it's set situated. And they walked off stage like buddies, you know, and they were talking. So later on, we went to the state of the art. They raised a lot of money. It was a fundraiser, about $3-4 million. and it had like a Folies Bergère thing show, and a group on the stage doing a Thriller and this and that. And we had the table together with Herbie, his wife, my wife, Frank Gehry, who designed the place, Dudamel, and John Williams, and his daughter. And someone asked, what were you and Herbie talking about when you walked off the stage, you know, doing the floor thing? What are you talking about? He said, Dudamel said, let's go boogie. And so John Williams got up. He got up. I said, he's going to leave. I said, okay, now you're going to leave me. He said, no, I'm going to boogie. He went to start dancing with his daughter, and Dudamel was dancing with his wife. And I said, this is a, I always say the wheels turning, the wheels. And when I was in Ann Arbor, Michigan, this was weather report day. We were, what do you call it? We had a promoter lady there. I walked by in a hallway by, there was a rehearsal going on. They were doing, somebody was doing Daphnis and Chloe, a small chamber. And behind the door, they were doing like the first couple of bars, four or five bars. Then something different was going on. And so the lady, the promoter, she said, oh, my daughter, she plays the French horn in that group. And she said, let's open the door a little bit and see what they're doing. She opened the door. She said, oh, what they're doing, they're practicing improvising in between measures. They're practicing improvising. So in Boston now, there's, there's things happening little bit, little by little, where entire large groups and orchestras, they're entertaining improvisational, improvising, but in baby steps, you know, improvising. And there's some way you can have, whether it's strings, the people furthest away from each other, you can hear each other immediately, but it's this they're going through an ear training. It's the dialogue with the development of improvising and then playing, reading music, and then another segment where the art of improvising, not with finality, like reaching something, I mean arriving somewhere, but reaching. And in that process, you throw out the window, I don't improvise. I can't sing. You sing, you don't sing. You're supposed to go to sleep at the ballet. You're supposed to go to sleep at the opera. Throw all that out. If the orchestra wakes up to new things, everybody else is going to wake up. So I'm going to be working with the Orpheus Chamber Orchestra too. No conductor, but you know, that's January at Carnegie Hall. And I've been commissioned. You heard about the commission? I commissioned to write an extensive piece for the LA Phil. It's extensive this time. And it's a piece called Gaia, the planet Gaia, you know, which with Esperanza Spalding, she's going to do the libretto and the quartet. It's all together. That's going to be done at Disney Hall first week or second week in February. Then the Detroit, the Nashville, they're partnering with the commission. They're all four. I think they're going to do it in Washington, too. Four more orchestras of five doing the same thing at appointed times, appointed, but, you know. So it pulled all the stops out. Danilo's writing. And let's get everyone in. We need lots of people. And I always say at the meetings, we need more novelists, filmmakers, whatever, independent. We need more of the blood and veins and everything of, you know, we need more of that. We need more of the dreamers. Make them dreams come true. I don't care how old you are, you know, don't care what age, you know, it's too late for me. So what did you guys do when you went out to the older people? What did you do when you went out to play when you were kids and you went back home and your mother would ask you, what were you doing? They said, nothing. Oh, nothing. Oh, we're playing. So all these psychologists, they can look at the whole thing. They say play is very important. Psychology 101, 202. But that thing, you know, Train was playing when he first started going. He was going, and people thought he couldn't play. He was like discarding how to actually play. He's pushing that other stuff out the way. Then the other thing started, you know. I think what Igor Stravinsky, he started trying to do his, what he called serial, after the Rite of Spring and all that. And a few others. Mozart was a jazz musician. The word jazz didn't exist, but he was doing it. That cymbal beat right there in G minor 40. I used to play stuff alongside the records when I was 16 on my clarinet. Stan Getz said he did the same thing. We were hanging out together before he passed, you know, me and Stan. I took when he had the cancer, I took the ginger, hot towel with ginger wrapped, you know, on the bed with him and out in the Malibu. He got the house out there. He said, man, it's nice to have a buddy with this stuff. I said, yeah, good time. Then he called me from the Johnny Carson show. He said, they're going to get married. And it was a twin. He married one of the, he passed away. But we spent that time together. We spent some time in Brazil together, too. Just for a night, you know, he played at the Cesar Park Hotel, and I joined him on the last set, playing that thing that Gretchen sang. It was more, you know, in the box, you know.
Chega de Saudade?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Chega. Chega. So having an interview with kids, not kids or peers or whatever, to me it has to be like a dialogue. I know this is one in another format, but it's a dialogue, and to make this sound like a dialogue without having me sound like I'm, you can't sound like a know-it-all. It's like supposition. Everything that's thrown out of court, this is what this is. This is pure supposition. But it's not.
But this is just journey,
yeah.
What we're talking about.
Yeah.
This is not judgment. We're
yeah.
not evaluating this.
Yeah. And it's something to think on, because when we read a book, a book that you kind of enjoying and very interesting, you don't stop and say, I want to change this. I would write this way. Let it go. And depends on what you're reading, too.
Do you analyze when you listen to music or read or walk the streets or,
no,
or just respond?
I don't know. Maybe it's a little analytical stuff. But it has to be... the analytical thing has to be part of a fabric, which is the thing that space is supposed to be now. Like a fabric of, has to be, the analytical thing has to be attached to something else. Like the door, a hinge or something, and something else has a function within. And it's, I don't know what it is. It's, a thousand, you say 3,000 realms in the momentary existence. 3,000 realms in a momentary existence, which my life condition contains. I can, if you want to put a number to it, 10, or 9, or 10. Sometimes in a condition of hell, hunger, animality, rapture, there's a place called, like, when you're studying, you say, put the food under the door, I'm busy, I'm making a monster. Then the other one, and there's another one, there's an aspiration for, and that's altruism, aspiration for enlightenment and enlightenment. And but when you're in hell, in the hellish condition, hellish circumstances, there's 10. The other nine exist in each one. So it becomes like the number 3,000 in the momentary, it's a moment where you, that your hellish condition can be enlightened. When you say, don't try to convert your evil nature or the devil, they say, make demons and devils your allies. How do you do that? He said, well, it seems like we call kendo kyaku, is it turning poison to medicine. Don't try to avoid the poison, turn it to medicine. That sounds like Tai Chi to me. But it's really something when you try to say it's not like Tai Chi.
When you listen to music or look at art or watch a film, what are you listening for? What are you watching? What are you looking at?
I'm listening for struggle and victory. Struggle and victory and overcoming. And or also there's investigation or a question mark, you know, like question mark music. I'm listening for something that is saying no beginning, no end. The words beginning and end to me are like crutches, tools. They're artificial. They're to be used for, not to those ends, though, or those beginnings. They'd be used, but not to use us.
Isn't it human nature to crave resolution?
Yeah. To crave resolution only when you really know the value that exists beyond within that resolution. When you're creating value, they say the truth means nothing unless the truth can be made, can make value of the truth. And when you know you're creating value, you will always be greeted with great resistance. Like some people say, it's valuable for you to go home after a long trip. And there's a snowstorm. We're going to have to land in Shannon, Ireland for tonight. We'll pay for your overnight hotel. It's, oh, man, it's Christmas. I'm going to go home. Or the guy, I have the movie The Black Box, the guy who invented motion pictures with Robert Donat. Donat. And... I just got it. I have the Powell stuff. I can play Powell stuff now. And he died at the end of a big meeting with these businessmen. They took the patent and everything. And this old man came in there, and he said, "You are talking business and everything, but make sure you have this invention. Take it to your heart." They sit up, sit up, sit down, old man. So guys, shh, I want to hear what he has to say. Take this invention to your heart with this business and everything. They got kind of quiet. Then he walked a few steps and fell down and died. This is the end. Laurence Olivier was in this movie for 5 minutes. He wanted to be in this movie. And 60 other, Glynis Johns, a whole bunch of people. So they see who he is. They went in his pockets and they said, I don't know who he is. We said, what do you have? He said, 2 tickets to a theater. Then they made an American version of that, and the guy died at the end, the same guy, and he found 37 cents in his pocket. He had a hole in the pocket, he said, 37 cents. And at the end, there was a caption that says, and the credits were going up at the end, they said, 30 cents, at this time, 37 cents was the sum total of the human body when, what do you call it? cremated, and the ashes. The ashes and the elements and the minerals cost 37 cents. And that's what I'm looking for in music. I'm looking for that 37 cents. I'm looking for the, I'm looking for, this is how you can say, was this guy born with a silver spoon in his mouth, the way he's writing? And, you know, the intention, what can't be judging all the time, but the intention. I'm looking for a chance-taking. Really, not just breaking the rules. Breaking the rules is different from taking chances.
What's the difference?
Like you can hear somebody, they can hear happy birthday a certain way, a happy birthday, and it's taking chances. Then you can hear something, that's breaking the rules. They hear happy birthday done in a way, it's, taking chances. It also depends on who's doing happy birthday. I never thought he would do that, or she, what? And it's kind of nice. Hmm. It's different too. Yeah, some altar chord. There's one little altar chord right there. And hey, I never. It's something that knocks you, all of us off our little pedestal. And it's a long time between those knocks. It's almost like when you're looking for a wife. That's what you're looking for. I mean, you know, to remember how it is to look for a wife. You know, for the genuine, we always say that, I'm looking for the, oh, that's a nice one. Ridley Scott should start Prometheus at the end. That should be the beginning. So where is she going? That's where I want to go. But I think Prometheus was a bunt so he can do the, knock the ball out of the park for the next one.
Good.
He dumb. Neither is Charlize Theron.
Okay, let's. My name is Larry Appelbaum. Today is September 24th, 2012. We are here with Wayne Shorter.